Gaither fans out there? Am I the only one? Am I the only Gaither fan in the house? Pretty much, huh? Cindy's with me. Yeah? Nobody else? You don't like them either? Come on, Kenny. Killing me, man. That's good stuff right there. Cindy likes it. You like the Detroit Lions? Well, there's three of you out there. I think that's great that someone could stick with a team that's awful. You're a true fan. Have you met my friend Mark? Yeah. Anyway, well, you'll be encouraged, for those of you that didn't raise your hand, that do not like the Gaithers, that this is the last night of this series. You'll never have to hear that again. No applause or nothing. I thought that would be the amen spot of the night, you know? I don't know. Man. Well, we're going to land the plane on this series here. The God of the mountain is the God of the valley, enjoying God's presence everywhere. Really, the whole idea behind the series was to give us a proper perspective of who God is. So I'll take you back a little bit. When we started the series, we referenced the story in 1 Kings chapter 20. Many of you, if you've been here for 4 or 5 weeks, you're going to say, I know that story, but maybe some of you were not here. And the reason we had this series was we wanted to experience God everywhere. And there's some folks in 1 Kings chapter 20 that doubted God's presence everywhere. They were this nation, Aram, and they had a king, Ben-Hadad, and they fought against, can you turn me down just a little bit, Jess? They fought against Israel, and apparently they had fought on the mountaintop. And so this battle had ensued on a mountaintop, and Israel crushed them. And so when they got done with that battle, they were a polytheistic culture, and they thought that like them, all the countries must have gods. We know better, right? Yeah, thank you. And so we have one God, and so they said, listen, let's gather up some more troops. And we'll fight them in the valley, because their gods are the gods of the mountain, but not the gods of the valley. So we'll beat them there. Well, they had a really bad perspective. And so what the Lord says is, I'm gonna let you guys, Israel, whoop them so bad that here's the message you'll get. I'm not the God of the mountain. I'm not the God of the valley. No, I am the Lord of all. Okay? And so that's where we got this series. And so we wanted to see how God visits his people, not only on the mountaintop, and we talked about some of us have mountaintop experiences. You know, we're on top of the world, everything's going great. And sometimes things aren't so good. We're in the proverbial valley when things are not going so great. And sometimes it's an experience that's brief, and sometimes it's an extended stay America. We're up on the top of the mountain for a long time, and things are soaring, and everything's going great. I'm rocking, I'm kicking it on all 8 cylinders. And then sometimes it's like we're in the gutter, we're in the dumps, and it's been like forever that we've been there, and we can't seem to get out of that. And so we realized through all the teaching here over the last couple weeks that no matter where you are, whether you're up here or you're down here, God is in both places doing his thing. He never stops. You know what I'm saying? He's still working no matter what your situation. So this week, as we close this thing out, I want to take us back to 1 Kings. But instead of 1 Kings chapter 20, we're going to start in 1 Kings chapter 18. That's going to be our visit to the mountaintop. So everyone have their hiking boots on, right? Everyone's got their hiking boots on. So we're going to read this story. I'm going to read it aloud, but not all of it. Let me just kind of tell you what's going on, and then we'll read bits and pieces of it, because otherwise it'll just take a little bit too long. But if you have your Bible, and I certainly hope that you do, you should turn to 1 Kings chapter 18. And if you do not have a Bible because you happen to forget yours at home, even though you bring it every other time you come here, but you can blame it on your spouse. She or he left it at home, and you asked them to bring it, and they forgot. So you don't have your Bible with you. And in that case, we have provided one for you. So we have yellow Bibles and we have orange Bibles, and you can take your pick, and they're about the same. You need one? There we go, right there. And you need one? I just did. So, I'm trying to come up with a good joke right then, but I had nothing. I have nothing. So, it's your kid, man. It's your kid. It's your kid. I do love him. I love him. So 1 Kings chapter 18, this is what's going on there. There's this guy, his name is Elijah, and this is Mount Carmel. Here's another mountain. We're going to actually go up on a mountain here, Mount Carmel with Elijah. And what's happening is that God has told him there's going to be a famine, and so he's told everyone, hey, there's going to be a famine, and who would like it if someone came to you and said, hey, there's going to be a famine? No one, I wouldn't make too many people happy, would it? Like, that's not the greatest news in the world. So here he is, and the people here, the king, they're like, oh, he's the troublemaker. He's predicted all this. He's called all this out on us, and nobody likes this guy. And so at the end, here in chapter 18, he says, listen, I have not made trouble for Israel. Verse 18, Elijah replied, you and your family, you're the king, you guys, you're the troublemakers. If you have refused to obey the commands of the Lord and have worshipped the images of Baal instead. So like they're worshipping idols, they're worshipping something other than the only one who should be worshipped. Amen. Right. And so this is what Elijah says. Summon all Israel. So that means like not just like some of you, all Israel, like all of God's people. How many people were there in Israel at the time? Like 2 million, right? Summon everyone, he said, not just a select group. But summon everyone because God's going to do something right now. And I want everybody to see it. So now summon all Israel and join me on Mount Carmel along with the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who are supported by this Jezebel. That's a whole other story. You can read about her and all that, but let's just say she's not nice. If you have a daughter, don't call her Jezebel. Oh, it's biblical. Bad name. Okay, bad name. Right, right. That's like right up there with like Adolf. And okay, don't do that. You don't, yeah, like, yeah. Here's our little kid, Lucifer. Like, that's not going to work, okay? So it's biblical. Really bad. Okay, so verse 20. So here's what happens. So Ahab, the king, right, he summons all the people of Israel in verse 20. And the prophets, all these people, he gets every, Elijah says, get all these people, and he's like, okay, I'll do it. And Elijah stood in front of them and says this, how much longer will you waver, hobbling between two opinions? This is a good place for an amen. You guys ready? Well, not yet. Hold on. You're just prepping. Prime the tank. Okay, prime the pump. Ready? Listen, how much longer will you waver, hobbling between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. Amen. 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 No more hot and cold. You know what I'm saying? Like, just either in or not. So he says, but if Baal is God, so he's like, you know, you guys make up your own mind. Like, I'm not going to tell you what to do. Just do what you want to do. But if Baal is God, then follow him. The people were completely silent. Silent. So, verse 22, then Elijah says to them, I am the only prophet of the Lord who is left, but Baal has 450 prophets. Now bring two bulls. The prophets of Baal may choose whichever one they wish and cut into pieces, lay the wood on their altar, but without setting fire to it. And I will prepare the other bull and lay it on the wood on the altar, and I will not set fire to it. Now, you guys, you call upon the name of your God, and I'll call upon the name of the Lord, in other words, you know, my God, and the God who answers by setting fire to the wood is the true God. So he makes a deal, and he's like, all right, let's get it on. And so that's what they do. The first point I want to make to you tonight is up on the mountain. If you've ever done any traveling to the mountains, you get to the peak and you look out and you're like, wow, awesome. You know, and I can see clearly now, the rain is gone. You can see everything. You're up on top of it all and you have clarity. You can see stuff that you couldn't see when you're down here because everything's around you. And you get up on top of the mountain and you can see far and wide. You got some clarity. You can see what's coming your way. You know when it's coming at you. You have a bird's eye view. You're on top of stuff. And so this story really teaches us here that what God is trying to do here is he's trying to teach us that what is popular isn't always the truth. Okay? And we live in a world where we seem to think that everyone has their ability to decide what's true. And popularity and majority vote decides what's true. And God's like, That's not the way that it works. It's not the way that it works. Clarity is not popularity. See, what was happening here is he's like, I'm the only one who's saying that this God is real. And over here, there's 850 other prophets that are saying all this. And so everyone's following them like sheep, like cattle. And Elijah's like, no, God's here. Just because everyone's doing it, that doesn't mean that it's the right thing to do. You know what I'm saying? So he's saying, listen, just because it's popular, that doesn't mean that it's true. If you go to 2 Timothy, and I want you to go to 2 Timothy chapter 4, all the way over into the New Testament. You know one of my favorite things to do? When you're quoting the Old Testament and you go right to the New, or you go in the New and you go right to the Old, and they're perfect match. That's awesome, right? 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, we're talking about clarity being, like, not everything that's popular is necessarily true. And so here's Paul, and he's talking to his young protege, Timothy, and they're immersed in this culture where everyone has their own idea of who God is and what religion should be, and you should believe in this God and that God, and Christianity, you have to be circumcised to be a Christian, you got to keep these laws to be a Christian, and Paul's like, no. Just because everybody's saying this, just because it's on Oprah and everyone should do this, that doesn't mean that it's right. And so Paul looks at Timothy and he says this in his letter. He says, I solemnly urge you, like it's like a pleading, like, listen, I beg you in the presence of God, like God is listening right now and he's urging you through my voice. He says, I solemnly urge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead when he appears to set up his kingdom, to do what? To preach the word. Preach the word. And it might not be popular, but preach the word anyway. Amen. And people will shun you and shame you, and they'll persecute you, and they'll tell you you're crazy, but preach the word of God. No one needs to hear a bunch of stories about your pet. They don't need to hear about your vacation so much. Pepper it in. But when you come to church, you're supposed to present the word of God. And it's not always popular. We're in a country where I can stand up and do this, and there's no soldiers busting down the door tonight to arrest me. But listen, make no mistake about it. It's not popular to do what I'm doing. It's not popular to preach from God's word, saying this is true, whether you agree with it or not. This is truth. Like, that's not popular. So he goes on to say, he says, preach the word of God and be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. You see, so just because everyone believed in Baal and everyone believed in Asherah and everyone's doing it, that doesn't mean that it's truth. Just because some churches are preaching certain things and they're fluffing people's ears, because it goes on to say that there's going to come a time when people aren't going to listen to sound doctrine. They're not going to even want to come to the church where a guy is standing up and with authority proclaiming God's word as truth. They don't want to hear that. They want to go to the church that makes them feel good, that lets them say, you know what, it's okay if you sin. Grace, 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 grace. God knows who I am. It's okay. That's the way he made me. It feels good. Why would he make this if he didn't want me to use it? He grew the plant. Let's smoke the heck out of it. Come on. Right? So it's not always truth just because it's popular. It says that people will gather teachers around them who will tickle their ears. They won't want to come to a church that challenges the foundation of their life with the truth of God's word. They want to find a preacher and a church that will tell them what they believe already. And when they come in the door and you challenge them with something they don't believe, they walk. Instead of doing what the Bible says, which is when Paul, the guy who wrote this stuff, preached, he even had people check the scriptures day and night to see if what he was saying was the truth. And he never shrunk back. What he did is invited the people to seek out the truth. And that's what the church needs to do. And that's what Elijah was doing. Not everything that's popular necessarily means that it's truth. We don't need any fluff at all, ever. So let's go back to the text and just see what else it has for us. You know, we have to read the text, but you know what? We need the text to read us, right? We need the text to read us. Let's go back. Look at verse 28. Well, you know what? No. Let's just go back to where I left off. All the people agreed. Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, "You go first. There are many of you. Choose one of the bulls, prepare it, and call on the name of your God. But do not set fire to the wood." And this is kind of a funny, I want you to, it's good to get into the story, right? Don't just read it, live it. Imagine yourself being there. So they prepared one of the bulls and placed it on the altar. Then they called in the name of Baal from morning until afternoon. So what's that? Long time? 2-3 hours? Give or take, right? What time do you breakfast? You don't eat breakfast. Figures, I count, I pick you. What time do you eat? You don't eat ever. Does anyone eat breakfast? What time do you eat breakfast?
I usually eat at school, I'd say about like 8:30 in the morning.
8:30, what time do you eat lunch?
I'd say at 12:30.
Okay, so what do we got, 4 hours? I don't know if that's what they did, but it seems pretty good to me. From morning until afternoon, till noontime. And this is what they did. "Oh, Baal, answer us! Oh, Baal, answer us!" For 4 hours. 4 hours. "Oh, Baal, answer us! Oh, Baal, answer us! Oh, Baal!" You get old. But they did it. But there was no reply of any kind. Say, duh. Well, that wasn't enough, though. Anyone want to get involved in the sermon? Come on, you're not supposed to read ahead of the preacher. No one wants to get involved in the sermon? Come on. You're going to make me a fool, aren't you? So when they yelled, "Oh, Baal, answer us," no reply. So what did they do? I'm not doing it. No, the scriptures say that when I come, I want to bring a spiritual gift that will bless you, but I want you to encourage me too. I'm not doing all the work. Then they danced, hobbling around the altar. I'm going to do the Humpty dance right now, right? First you limp to the side like your leg was broken, shaking and twitching. No. Stop. Don't do this. Don't go there. Don't do it. Then they danced, hobbling around the altar they had made. No. Y'all are making fun of me. I'd like to see you get up here and dance. The Humpty dance is a trance. I do the hump. Sexy baby. Okay, come on. Let's get back on track. So about noontime, Elijah, he's watching all this, right? Nothing's happened. And 2 million people around. There's 850 people raving, screaming crazy like a bunch of dodo birds. And about noontime, Elijah begins mocking them. "You'll have to shout louder." He's just having fun, right? "You idiots. Oh, Baal, that's not loud enough. Go louder. That'll work." He scoffs. "You have to shout louder. For surely he is a god." Elijah had this spiritual gift of sarcasm, which I absolutely appreciate. Yes, I've been gifted with that. Then he goes on, he says, "Perhaps he's daydreaming, this god." And I don't like this translation. This will make y'all laugh, but the New Living Translation says maybe he's relieving himself.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, their God's not pooping, and that's not what he meant. You go down to the bottom, and it says something totally different. I think they just really wanted a good laugh there. But that's really not what it says. It says maybe he's somewhere else, or he's engaged in business elsewhere. Or maybe he is away on a trip. Or he is asleep and needs to be awakened. Yeah. So they shouted, they took the bait. Stupid, right? So they shouted loud, "Oh, Baal, answer us! Oh, Baal, answer us!" And following their normal custom, but that wasn't good enough, so they cut themselves
with knives and swords until the blood gushed out. They raved all afternoon until the time of the evening sacrifice, but still there was no sound, no reply, no response. Duh. You see, what's happening here is Elijah is making a point. He's saying, you know all these things that I'm saying, I'm making fun of your gods? The reason why I'm saying this is because what I'm saying right here is everything that the one true God is not. Amen. Okay? That's not, you want to know the real God, it's not that God right there. And so that's what I want to do with you. I want to go over some of these things because this message series is what? To give you a proper perspective on God, because proper perspective creates proper worship. I don't want you to worship a fake God. And God will not allow that. Doesn't matter how much you scream and yell and cut yourself and scream. There's no one out there listening except Him. That's it. And so this is what I want to do. I want to go over some of these things with you. These are the things that God is not. Proper perspective up on the mountain. One, God is not daydreaming, like it says here. He is not daydreaming, and He's not busy elsewhere. He's not the God that's off in la-la land somewhere. He's not mentally detached. God, you know what I'm talking about, when you're talking to someone and they're just like, and you're talking and they're staring at you, but they're completely not engaged. That happens often. I understand that concept. Yeah. The point is, do you? I understand. I get it completely. That was for me. He's not elsewhere. God's not vegging, right? He's not there. That's not what He's doing. We learned last week that God is the God who says, I will be with you, is the word Rapha. I will not slacken, I will not cease, I will not fail, I will not leave you alone. I'm not slothful in my efforts. I'm not weak to provide and protect you. I will mend you. I will repair you. That is my commitment to you. The scriptures say, I'm certain of this, that the one who began a good work in you will continue to do so until the day of Christ Jesus. This promise of never leaving you is the Hebrew word azab, which means I will not loosen or relinquish my hold on you. I will not leave you destitute ever. I am present and I am on the job. That's the God of the Bible, not some made-up God in our heads. The Bible talks about this concept of abiding. If you will abide in me, I will abide in you. We learned this last week, and I know all of you saw it in your notes, that abiding means to be present, to stand in it, stay there, and be present. Not there physically and emotionally and mentally, you're gone, off in la-la land somewhere. That's not God. God says, I will be with you, I will be present, I will be paying attention. The noun tense of abide is abode. And God says, if I'm knocking on the door and if you let me in, I will come and make my abode, I'll make my dwelling with you. I'm going to be there, that's where I'm going to live, I'm going to hang out there. I am very present. I'm not far away, busy doing something else elsewhere. I'm here. I am present. I'm on the job. The next thing that it says is, well, maybe your God's away on a trip. I love the sarcasm. Okay, well, that's not our God. There's this crazy 17th and 18th century movement known as deism. Some of you may have heard of it, but it suggests that by reason points to the reality of a creator, but denies the reality that this creator still is present now and interacts with his creation right now. Okay? But that's not the Bible. That's not the picture that the Bible paints of our God. Okay? Here's where I want you to have fun. I want you to do this for me. I want you to say, yo, preacher. You got a verse for that? No, you got to do better than that. Yo, preacher, you got a verse for that? I got six of them. I got six of them. You guys ready for them? You got your pen, right? Six verses that tell otherwise. That He's not some God that started everything and said, oh, that looks good. That's what it says in the beginning of creation, right? He did it. It was very good. Hey, this is good work. I'm out of here. See ya. That's what deism teaches, right? That's not what the Bible teaches. Psalm 139:7. Where can I go to get to escape your presence? Where can I go to escape your presence? David said that although I walk through the shadow, the darkest places, the valley of the shadow of death, I shall not fear. Why? Because you're with me. Because you're with me. 2 Chronicles 16:9 is one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. Listen, the eyes of the Lord go back and forth across the earth, looking to strengthen those whose hearts are completely his. You might say, well, what's God doing right? What are you doing right now? You're in church. You're listening, right? So you might want to say, well, what's God doing? What's God doing right now? I'll tell you what he's doing. He's watching right now. He's going back and forth across the earth right now. Not way back then, 4,000 or 5,000 years ago. No, right now. The eyes of the Lord go back and forth across the earth looking to strengthen those whose hearts are completely his. So here's the question I have. Is he going to stop at your house? Is his eyes going to go, whoop, Michael, there's a heart that's completely mine. I'm not just in the rescuing business. I'm in the advancement business. And I'm looking to strengthen the guy who's completely mine. I want to hook that guy up and use him for awesome stuff. So I'm asking you, is he stopping at your place? Because that's what he's doing right now. He's watching right now, and he wants to strengthen those that have already made the decision. I'm in, Lord. I'm in. So maybe that's why you're not experiencing all that salvation would provide for you, because you haven't made that choice to go all in yet. And he's waiting for that time. He's there to rescue you when you're fallen, but he's also there to hook you up large when you're all in, when you're all in. Psalm 34:18 says that the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and rescues those whose spirits are crushed. Kind of self-explanatory there, right? The claim is that he's close. He's here. He's not off somewhere. He's close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. I'm down. I'm out. I'm in the valley. I'm hurting. I'm scared. I'm worried. I'm broken. I need help. And you cry out to the Lord, and wham, boom, he's right there. That's what the Bible teaches us. He's not some faraway God. The scriptures tell us somewhere that his ear is not too deaf to hear the cries of his people, and his arm is not too short to reach and save. Doesn't matter where you are, he's right there. Which, of course, explains Psalm 145:18. There's another one. The Lord is near to all who call on him. People of Paris need to know that. They need to know that. Here's another one, Psalm 149:4. The Lord delights in his people. That's a good one. You know, because it's not a direct thing that says the Lord is close to his people. It just says he delights in his people. So you got to kind of use your imagination a little bit, but think about that. If he's some God that created all this and made you and made the earth and all that stuff, and then he split, could he be that God that's delighting in his people? Would a grandparent put pictures up of their grandkids on the fridge and all over the walls for a kid that they never even knew or met? Right? You don't. Would you do that? Who does that? So what is the assumption here? So if you delight in the Lord, if you delight in the people, you must have some type of relationship with them, right? Which leads us right into Zephaniah 3:17. It says, this is direct, for the Lord God is living among you. And it goes on to say that in that nearness where he's among you, that he rejoices and sings over you. That's awesome. He sings over you. See, you think that it's Jessica and Grayson up there singing, but it's really not. The Lord God is here, and he's singing over you. He's rejoicing and is delighting in his people. God is not mentally detached, daydreaming. He is not physically detached, away on a trip. Here's the third thing. Maybe your God is asleep or needs to be awakened. Hey, preacher. Terrible. Hey, preacher. You got a verse for that? I'm glad you asked. I got four. I'm slipping. Here's one. Psalm 121:3. I love when scripture's direct. You don't need a fancy preacher, a talented guy to explain this one. The one who watches over you will not slumber. Pretty self-explanatory, right? Do you need me to explain all that? No. How about this one? Very next verse. Indeed, he who watches over Israel never slumbers or sleeps. Israel is not a land. Did you know that? It's a people. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Jacob's name was changed to Israel, representing all of the people that were in Israel. The nation would come through that lineage. Basically, it's just the people who believed in God. That's us. You believe in God? Yeah, I do. You're part of Israel. And so the one who watches over you, and that's not watched, is it? Is it past tense or is it present and future? It's watches over you, never slumbers or sleeps. Here's verse 8. The Lord keeps, that's a big word, keeps watch over you as you come and go, both now, say now, and forever. What's that mean? Always, right? Always. He's not sleeping. He doesn't need to be awakened. He's watching you. He's here all the time. He's monitoring you. He's watching you. His eyes go back and forth constantly. He keeps going and going and going and going and going and going. He never stops.
And going and going.
Here's another one. Isaiah 40, verse 28. Have you never heard? Maybe you've never heard. See, Isaiah is about to tell you something. Maybe this stuff that I'm telling you don't understand it. No one ever told you this, that God is a God who never sleeps. He's always on the job. Maybe no one ever told you that. And Isaiah's like, hey, listen, maybe have you never heard? Or maybe you've heard it, but you've never understood it. It never sunk in. No one ever explained it to you. Have you never understood? The Lord is the everlasting God. He's the everlasting God. He never punches out. Never. He's never tired. He's got the earth spinning on his finger like the Harlem Globetrotters with his feet up in his recliner. He never tires. How many people think that they have a hard job? You can raise your hand. Anyone have a hard physical job like digging ditches, building bridges, like tough, right? Anyone have a hard day at work today?
Today?
How many hours you work today, Tim? Just eight. How many? You work 9. Anyone work more than that? 11. Who works 11? Oh, you got a new job. That's cool. Yeah. How many hours did you work today? Not today. Anyone have a hard job, though, that like you put in 10, 12, 14 hours labor, building asphalt plants, welding where it's 1,000 degrees and you're inside some... You know, what's that?
40 hours straight.
Up to 40 hours straight. Tiring, right? When you get done with that, what do you want to do? You want to mimic God. You want to get in that recliner, right? Oh, just wore out. But see here, this is what Isaiah says. I love this. He says, the Lord is the everlasting God. What's that mean? Well, this is the creator. He's the creator of all the earth. So what he's doing is he's saying, listen, do you have a hard job? You worked 40 hours. You welded a conveyor. How many houses are on this earth? Billions of them, right? Just tons of houses, right? And one person could work all day and lay all the flooring in that one house. Maybe it's 3,500 square feet, and you'd be exhausted, wouldn't you? Well, this is calling us all out. He's saying, listen, I'm the creator of all the earth. And I never grow weak or weary. Nothing tires me out. You have a rough day at work. You need to put your feet up. Whee. I made everything, and I'm not tired. I'm the everlasting God. I'm on the job always, and I never tire. Go back into the text. So Elijah calls to the people, verse 30, come over here. They all crowded around him as he repaired the altar of the Lord that had been torn down.
He took 12 stones, one to represent each of the tribes of Israel, and he used the stones to rebuild the altar in the name of the Lord. Then he dug a trench around the altar large enough to hold about 3 gallons, like just like a moat, if you will. He piled the wood on the altar, cut the bull into pieces, and laid the pieces on the wood. Then he said, fill 4 large jars with water and pour the water over the offering and the wood. So how many people like to camp? Yeah. How many people would do that to their fire before they lit it? Yeah. That would not be smart, right? This is what he's doing. After they had, I love the Bible, everything you plan on doing, completely opposite. After, that's how you know it's true. Who would ever write this? After they had done this, he said, do the same thing again. And when they were finished, he said, now do it a third time. Make sure it's completely soaked. So they did as he said, and the water ran around the altar and even filled the trench. So now you can see what's going on, right? You can visualize it. At the usual time for the offering, for offering the evening sacrifice, Elijah the prophet walks up to the altar and prays. Now remember, this is in front of all the people. Everyone is watching. O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, prove today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant. Prove that I have done all this crazy stuff, right? All of this at your command. O Lord, answer me. And answer me so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God and that you have brought them back to yourself. And immediately the fire of the Lord flashed down from heaven and burned up the young bull, the wood, the stones, got to be hot, and the dust. It even licked up all the water in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell face down on the ground and cried, the Lord, he is God. Yes, the Lord is God. Amen. Listen. Clarity invokes worship. Do you understand? When they realized who God really was, there was only one response, and that is to fall on their faces and cry out, the Lord is God. Try that with me. Get out of your comfort zone. Just yell it out. The Lord is God. That's worship. Like when you come to grips with the fact of who God really is, when he's rightly viewed and understood, when the eyes of your heart have been opened up to the reality of who he is, there's only one thing you can do, and that is to fall on your face and realize you're small and realize he's big and say, the Lord is God. That's all you can do. Clarity invokes worship. On the mountain, there was clarity. And we can see far and wide, and there's no obstructions in front of us. We have a fuller view of what's before us. Puts us in a position of power and authority. We're kind of on top of the world, right? It's good to be up there. We can see clearly. We can know stuff. We have a bird's eye view. But, you see, but in the valley, it's different. See, in the valley, it can be extremely dark. And visibility is limited. And the mountains that once elevated you up to a position of power and authority and clarity are now those same mountains that surround and cover you, and they feel like they tower over me, and they make me feel helpless and hopeless and weak. But we've learned, I hope you've learned over the last couple weeks, that God can even meet you there. He met Nehemiah there. When Nehemiah was down and sad because the people he loved, the city that he loved, like he loved his city like the people in Paris love their city, right? And when this stuff happens, we mourn for that. And Nehemiah was mourning for that. The Israel had been destroyed. And so when he's in that valley of despair, he simply prays, and the Lord meets him right where he is and grants him favor with the opposing king to give him all the materials he needed to rebuild that city. That's unheard of. But that's what God did. He met Paul and Silas in the prison. You remember that? Paul and Silas, they were beaten with a wooden stick and then thrown into the inner dungeon together. Uh-oh.
Don't do that, devil. Don't put two Christians in the same place, because when two or more are gathered in his name, there he is, right? There's Jesus. He shows up again, and they start praising him in the jail cell, and what happens? The earth starts shaking, and the door swings open, and all the chains fall off everybody. God meets him in the valley, and he met Joseph last week. Joseph was thrown into a cistern or a well to die, sold into slavery, accused of rape, thrown in jail. But the Lord was with him, it says, and showed him great favor, whether he was in the prison or in the palace. The Lord was with him. And so tonight, the valley, well, this is the best one yet. And even if you're not a believer, you know this guy. I could ask you right now, who's the guy that went to the deepest, deepest valley ever?
Job.
You know it. Job. And that's where God meets tonight. He meets Job, and we will meet him there. So turn to Job. And let's just kind of tell you what happens to Job. Will God even meet me there? Well, let me tell you what happened to Job. Some of you said that you have a tough job. How many people have said, can say they've had a tough day or a kind of a tough season of life these last few months or years? Anyone? Been kind of rough at times? Well, let me read you a little bit. Job chapter 1, right at the beginning, there was a man named Job who lived in the land of, I guess it's Uz. It's not Oz. That'd be kind of cool. It's Uz. He was blameless. None of us can say that. A man of complete integrity. None of us can say that either. Complete integrity. This guy was rocking, right? He feared God and stayed away from evil. He had 7 sons, 3 daughters. He owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 teams of oxen, 500 female donkeys. He also had many servants. He was, in fact, the richest person in that entire area. Would you say that this man is on the mountain or the valley? He's on a mountaintop, right? Now, but, verse 13. One day, while he's living this life out of just awesomeness on the mountain, everything's going great. One day when Job's sons and daughters were feasting, so that's good, they're having a feast, right? People that are really struggling, they don't have feasts, do they? He's doing pretty well. Feasting at the older brother's house, a messenger arrived at Job's home with this news. Your oxen were plowing with the donkeys feeding beside them when these people, Sabaeans, raided us. They stole all the animals and killed all the farmhands. I am the only one who escaped to tell you. Bad news? Okay, now listen to this. This is the worst part of it. While that messenger was still speaking, this is not the next day or the next month or the next year of a season. While that messenger is saying that these people came in and killed all your farmhands, while the guy was still standing there, still talking, another messenger arrived with this news. The fire of God has fallen from heaven and burned up your sheep and all the shepherds. I'm the only one who escaped to tell you. Where's that going? Down, 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 right? Listen, verse 17. While that guy was still speaking, a third messenger arrives with this news. 3 bands of Chaldean raiders have stolen your camels and killed your servants. I'm the only one who escaped to tell you. Where's that going? Show me. Down, right? Things are not so good anymore. Verse 18, while that guy was speaking, this is getting worse and worse every minute, right? Do you ever have one of them days? Really? You know, the car breaks down, and as you're getting out, you stub your toe. Really? We all think that's bad. Right now, I got a sore in my mouth because I bit through my lip, right? My whole face is a lip right now. Did you see anything except the lip? Because that's all I feel. And I think that that's rough, right? While he was still speaking, another manager arrives with this news. Your sons and daughters were feasting in their oldest brother's home. Suddenly, a powerful wind swept in from the wilderness, hit the house on all sides. The house collapsed, and all your children are dead. Mountain or valley?
Valley.
How about this one? Chapter 2, verse 6. Satan left the Lord's presence because that wasn't bad enough. And he struck Job with terrible boils from head to toe. So Job is scraping his skin with a piece of broken pottery as he sat among the ashes. So just, can you put yourself in this story? I hope you say no. There's no way. No one's ever had it this bad. Ever. Right? Ever. And the wife, you know, you want to go home and be encouraged by your spouse, don't you? This wife does not get the Wife of the Year award. And she looks at him instead of encouraging him and saying, honey, it's okay, you know, you're a good man, I love you. Are you still trying to maintain your integrity? Curse God and die. Not a good wife. Not good at all. So here's, like, things are bad, right? Bad. So what's our response as people when things are bad? Because we're talking about God in the valley, right? Because if this is happening, are you thinking about how good God is? Remember, we talked about this is supposed to be perspective change. You need a perspective change. See, it doesn't matter the circumstance. The circumstance never changes the nature and character of the Almighty. And so, what's Job's response? What does he do? Look back at the end of chapter 1 when he finds out about all the stuff that had happened to his family and his stuff. Verse 20, Job stood up and he tore his robe in grief. So, like, if things are bad, I mean, it's understandable to grieve, right? Does he say not to grieve? No, he stood and he tore his robe in grief, and then he shaved his head and fell to the ground. To complain? To grumble? To curse God? Or to worship? That's convicting. That makes me feel like I really suck. You know, whatever, if you don't like my language. But that's what it does to me. Like, because when I have something that's kind of not my way, like I complain and complain, you know what I mean? Really? He worshiped. And when he worshiped, what did he say? He said, I came naked from my mother's womb, and I will be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had, and the Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord. He did not sin. Now listen, remember when Paul and Silas were in jail and they praised God? God showed up. And when Job was in this jail and he praised God, God showed up. And if you read chapter 38 through 41, it was like on Sinai when God came and spoke to Moses and the people. It was the same thing, but he spoke to Job in the valley. Just like he spoke to the people on the mountain, he spoke to Job in the valley, and he came in and he gave him a clear description in detail of who he was. Job, this is who I am. I know you have all these troubles, but listen, don't think about that. Think about me. Focus on me, son. This is who I am. I direct the raindrops, the thunder, the lightning. You think the animals hunt their own food? No, I feed them. Everything is under my control. Job, I got this, brother. I got this. And he gave him a detailed description of who he was and how powerful he is. And the fact that he even spoke to Job indicated just how near he was to Job. Remember Psalm 34:18, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. And he shows up and he says, this is who I am, Job. You don't need to worry. I got this, man. I got this. And so, like last week I shared with you, when God says, I'm with you, it's not just I'm here. I'm going to prove that I'm here by showing you my unfailing love. That's what I'm here means. Not just lip service. Hey, I'm here. Call me if you need me. No, I'm going to show you that I'm here by proving to you my unfailing love. And so if you look at the very end of Job, In chapter 42, this is what Job says, and this is what happens. Verse 2, I know that you can do anything, and no one can stop you. You ask me, God, who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorance? It is I, Job. And I was talking about things I knew nothing about, things too far wonderful for me. You said, listen, and I will speak. I have some questions for you, and you must answer them. I had only heard about you, but now I have seen you with my own eyes. I take back everything I said. Job now had proper perspective of who God was, and it created worship. And what happens is, in chapter 3, Job's saying about what's going on, hey, I'm in a valley. Chapters 4 through 37, his friends show up to try to tell him what's going on. Explain away what's happening. Listen, we got too many experts in this world. Way too many experts in this world. And you know, Colossians 2:3, it says that in Christ lie hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So, like, when you have something going on in your life, don't go looking for all the secular advice and people telling you this and telling you that. Follow your heart. You deserve to be happy. Listen, if they're not throwing scripture your way, tell them you don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. And so God shows up. And he says, Job, I want you to pray for those knuckleheads who try to tell you what's going on. They don't have a clue. And it says in verse 10 of chapter 42, when Job prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes. In fact, the Lord gave him twice as much as before. Because of all the trials the Lord had brought against him, the Lord blessed Job in the second half of his life even more than he did in the beginning. He showed up in the valley. So this series, God of the Mountain, God of the Valley, it started with Aram thinking that they could crush God's people in the valley because they had a false perspective of God. And they thought Israel's God lived in one place. He was, and so therefore he had limited power. And so Aram's perspective was wrong. And proper perspective of God leads to proper worship of God, and the improper perspective of God leads to bad news. And they got crushed because they had a wrong perspective of who God is. God was on the mountaintop. He's always on the mountain meeting his people and offering them victory and clarity and vision and prosperity and identity and perspective. This is who I am, and this is who you are. Get your eyes off of other stuff. Get your eyes off of the Moses and Elijah, the things that are good, and get your eyes on the Son, Jesus Christ. That is my Son who I'm well pleased. Listen to him. There's things that are good, but they're not great. Get your eyes off the good and get it on the great. Pay attention to Jesus. But things sometimes change, and so when you're down in the valley, it's a little dark, and it's a little, you know, why? Why me? Why me? And we're not super holy, perfect people, so we can admit that there's times when there's pain and there's fear and loss and worry. But the scriptures tell us, Peter tells us, don't be surprised by the fiery trials, as if something strange is happening. Jesus said, in this life you will have troubles. And James said, consider it a joy when these troubles come your way. Just consider it a joy. Doesn't mean you have to, but you can at least consider it. Think about this. Might be an opportunity that God's trying to do something. I just bit that lip again. Ooh. He's trying to do something in your life. Maybe he's trying to bless a bunch of people, and he needs to put you in a situation like he did with Joseph and with Paul. That guy needed to get saved, the jailer. So God put him in the jail so he could lead this guy to the Lord and lead Onesimus to the Lord so he could go back to Philemon and spread the gospel through that town. Maybe that's what he's doing in your valley. Maybe he's trying to discipline you. The Lord chastens those he loves. Something's wrong in your life. He's trying to get your attention. So maybe he's disciplining you. Maybe that's your valley. Maybe that's your valley. I don't know. I just want to close here. You know, last week, Joseph taught us that it's not just that God allows valleys. This was a tough one to swallow, but it's true. Sometimes God himself puts you in that valley. He may be putting you into that valley. But our God
And this is perspective. Our God never wastes a valley. Never, ever will he waste a valley. That is the real God of the Bible. He's a God who's always with you, always working on you, always providing for you. He's a God that rushes in to ease the brokenhearted. He shows his unfailing love as proof of his presence. He's a God that responds to the cries and the praises of his kids. And when you praise, if I could leave you with one story, it's this, I think the greatest one of all. It's Paul in the prison. When he's whipped and beaten and thrown into the inner dungeon and his feet get shackled, and he starts singing songs to God. And when he did, that God shook the earth and whipped open the door and broke the chains off, not just Paul and Silas, but everyone in the prison, even the people that didn't believe in God. Why? So Paul could lead them to the Lord. And so that's the kind of God he is. He's also the God that gives you purpose. Purpose, listen, loved ones. He gives you purpose. He screams, you're free. The jail doors are open. You're free to live the life that I designed you to live, to worship me, for me. Everything was created by me and for me. You're free to live that. But your purpose is not just to be free for yourself. It's to go and serve others in his name that they might know, love, and enjoy him for eternity. That's the God of the Bible. I hope we've been able to give you a proper perspective of who God is, although we've not even scratched the surface of who he is. Starting next week, we're going to start our Christmas series. Isn't that crazy? Our Christmas series. And it's really more of the same. We're kind of boring around here. We just preach about Jesus, if you guys are cool with that, right? And so there's a lot of questions about why did Jesus come? And people have their own ideas, but you know what? The Bible actually says several times, I came too. And he tells you why. And so for 5-6 weeks, that's what we're going to do. We're going to study what Jesus came to do so you can know God and worship him well. I'd like to ask, could I get two guys to come pass out this communion right here real quick? But I want to ask, can you kill these lights? This is important. And the reason why I want to kill these lights is a lot of times people get shy, and I totally understand. And I don't want you to fear. I don't want to put up any obstacles that will keep you from this. The most important decision you'll ever make in your life is who is Jesus. That's it. You will not ever remember 1,000 or 5,000 years from now what you had for dinner tonight or what shirt you wore. But you will know what you did with Jesus. We've tried over the last month or so to describe to you who this God is. I don't know who you've been worshiping. Maybe you've been worshiping that God. I certainly hope so. But maybe you weren't. As these men give out communion, I'd like to give you an opportunity. I'd like to give you an opportunity to respond. The scriptures tell us in John 16 or 17, somewhere in there, it says that the Holy Spirit's job is to do three things. Although there's many, but three main things. To convict us, convict the world of our sin, to point out God's righteousness, and to warn us of the coming judgment. What this is it's God's Spirit telling you, you're broken and you cannot fix yourself. And the second thing he does is points to God's righteousness. He says, you can't fix yourself, but he can, and only he can. So you're broken, you need a Savior, Christ is the one, and the coming judgment. In other words, do it now. There's urgency in his plea. And I want to give you that opportunity right now. If you've never surrendered your heart to the Lordship of Christ, I'm pleading with you as if the Holy Spirit was speaking through me. Coming judgment. Do it now. Do it now. Do it now. I'm not here to frighten you in any way. I'm just being honest. Everyone on the news tonight that was killed or murdered those people perished, they never knew this was coming. They never, no one ever knows, and we don't know. And I'm pleading with you,
If you've never given your heart to Christ, come see me. And let's pray. And let's all, and listen, that's the beautiful thing about God. I don't know what other churches will teach you, but it's so simple. You just have to say, I'm wrong, you're right, be my God and save me through your Christ. That's it. That's it. That's it. You don't have to study the scriptures first. You don't have to attend seminary. You don't have to put money in the plate. You just got to say, Lord, I want you, I want to accept the gift of eternal life because Christ went on the cross to pay for my sin. That's it. That's all I want. That's all I want. And so I want to do that with you. I want to pray with you. And if you want to say yes, let's just do this. So I'm going to have the guys pass out communion. Hold on to it. We'll come back and we'll take it together. But again, if you feel inclined, come and let's pass that way. This is Leon. Leon, I'm going to make this quick. Water's a little cold. Leon, like many of us in this room, you don't have to sit yet. Many of the people in this room have had histories that are not the history we would have written for ourselves. Our parents wouldn't have written them for us, but it's a history. But he's made the quality decision to look at that life and say, I don't want that anymore. Jesus, I want you to be the Lord of my life, and I want to begin to live for you. I want to begin to die so that you, Lord Jesus, can live through me. And that's the decision that Leon has made. Who's your one and only Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ.
Have a seat with me real quick. Based on that confession, I now bury you with Christ. And like him, you'll be raised to new life because you trusted in the mighty power of God that raised Christ from the dead. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Down.